to thank everyone for being here today. I want to thank those of you who were able to travel such far distances and make it here to be with us on such short notice. To honor the passing of my mother, Pamela Jean Ward, I'd like to call our first speaker, Penny. My mom's second cousin, for those of you who may not know her.
Penny? First cousin.
First cousin. My second cousin. Apologies.
She was like a sister to me.
She was like a cousin to me!
Happy birthday, mean Pamela Jean. For those of you that don't know, that was her cage fighter name back in the day. Pam had many names. Lila was one of them. She used that name when she was undercover. And she had many talents, many abilities. But when I think of Pam, I think of party planner. Because she was really good at that. Give Pam a string of twinkle lights, some crepe paper and a bag of balloons, and she'd give you a 50 sock hop or a hee-haw hold down, or maybe an 18th century masquerade ball. By a show of hands, I'd like to know who's acquainted with Pam's parties. Anybody out there? She was really good at getting you drawn into it, right? Telling you, if you just help me this one time, we'll make it really simple. Low budget, hardly any work at all. Anybody heard that? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All my life.
Sounds like your daughter.
But she had a way of pulling you in with her enthusiasm. And I remember one Saturday afternoon, summer day, and Pam and I and a bunch of the cousins were decorating at the Sisney Community Center. There was going to be a party and a dance that night. I don't remember what the theme was, maybe Roaring Twenties. But we're working away and we ran out of scotch tape. And Pam, being the helpful, kind person she is, volunteered to go the two blocks down to the store and get the tape for us. So she left. Mm-hmm. And she was gone.
She was gone!
And she was gone, and she was gone! And then suddenly she burst into the room and she said, "Hey guys, you're not going to believe this. This is really weird." Apparently Pam had taken a shortcut across the Sisney Square, the little park there, to get to the store. And as she walked, she saw there was a gentleman also taking a walk through the park. The first impressions were really important to Pam, and the fact that he was only wearing his underpants with a paper bag on his head did not make a good impression on Pam. And she hightailed it over to the store and contacted the proper authorities to let them know somebody was freezing in the park. But she told us, you know, that it was really a strange thing. And it was. It was strange and odd and weird, like she said. But really not that unusual for Pam. Mm-hmm. Strange things happen to Pam all the time. Mm-hmm. Weird people. Mm-hmm. We're around Pam all the time.
Oh, yeah.
And I think, ladies and gentlemen, family and friends, it's time we admit Pam was a weird magnet.
Weird magnet. Weird magnet.
Yeah. Is there anybody else you know who would happen to have the phone numbers? Note this. The phone numbers of half a dozen Amish people in her phone? I'll give you a moment to let that sink in. Amish people at phone. Okay. Anybody else that had four or five people she knew who lived in haunted houses?
Weird.
I don't know anybody else.
Weird.
Anybody else who had two friends who had complete gorilla costumes? Just Pam. She was a weird magnet. And I think that now that she's gone, I mean, no, it wasn't that unusual. We can look back and say, if we need more proof, look to your right. Look to your left.
Mm-hmm.
Look to the people seated around you. There's not a person here that is quite right, normal. All are missing a block or two.
Or teeth.
Yep, we were drawn to Pam's weird magnet. And we know that Pam's party planning days are over here on Earth.
No more parties!
No more parties with Pam. But I think if now we would just close our eyes for a moment and imagine, just imagine, that Pam could actually be here watching us, hearing us, I think she would be smiling. I think she would say, those are my weirdos. And I just want to say, rest in peace, Pam. Party on.
Amen, sister. Cousin.
At this time, I'd like to call our second speaker, Doyle. Also my mother's cousin.
I'm her twin.
We can tell.
My reaction was probably different than most people's whenever I got the news. This is the first thing that popped into my mind. Let the joyous news be spread. The old wicked witch is dead at last. Ding dong, the witch is dead. The wicked witch, the wicked witch. Ding dong, the wicked witch is dead. She's gone where the goblins. And I thought about it. Something dark crossed my mind.
A flying monkey?
No. I'm her cousin, Doyle. I got news that she had passed. But I had watched for years her nefarious ways and how they progressed. From childhood, she had been plotting and planning things that are horrendous, even in our family. It started on a small farm in Sisney, Illinois, at my granddad's. Granddad was talking to her, and he told her all about horses and ponies and how she should stay away from them. They could be dangerous. And that made her mad because he didn't warn Cousin Penny. She plotted his demise.
He's dead.
Spent hours and he's dead. One time, their grandmother Ruth was at Sisney and she was laying on a couch in the kitchen with Gila. And Gila was just a mere child. And their grandfather came up to Gila because she was crying and kind of slapped her and said, "Hush up." That made Pam mad. She plotted his demise also.
He's dead.
I mean, every move, every job. And I started watching her as time goes by. And I remember her first job, and I'm like, how odd. But her first job was kind of a waitress slash dancer at a crazy little shack beyond the track. And everybody called it the Sugar Shack. The Sugar Shack was quite the place. And it did eventually get shut down by the local authorities, but by the time they came and shut the place down, she had already started making contact with Little Lonnie. Little Lonnie was mobster. So she had started this trend, and the darkness continued. I could see one time she even became a rescue person. She took the classes And she was on a team that was quite well known. And it was Rescue 8. They were always rescuing people. Every week, just like clockwork, there was Rescue 8. And she was in the middle of it. But do you think she was doing it? Doing it out of the kindness, the altruicity of her heart? Oh, I tell thee, nay. I finally found out what it was all about. She wanted to learn how to bind up wounds, how to cover, how to dispose of bodies and body parts. Finally, they figured that out, and they closed it down also. Then as she grew up, she realized she needed another skill to add to this. She went to cosmetology school, better known as beauty school. But do you think she was there studying to help other people? No. She learned how to make makeup, how to put it on her face, how to dye her hair, how to wear wigs. She was doing it so she could alter her own appearance and move among crowds without anybody seeing her. And then after a few years, she was quite the party animal. And all at once, she became a Baptist. Oh my gosh. A Baptist. I mean, all the fun was just sucked right out of all the... I just couldn't believe it. And she pulled it off so sincere-like. You would have thought she was a real one, but no. Most of you people also don't know, and I just want to give you some more information. Most of you people that might not know this, the family does, her father was in the military. And I know for a fact, I witnessed it with my own eyes, he used to bring home explosives. And he taught her how to use those explosives. He also brought home fire things, you know, flares, how to set fires, boom, on houses far away. She learned. She became experienced. He brought home not only explosives, but also weaponry, bayonets. And he would take her out and he taught her how to, quote, plink those cans. But that's not what was going on, actually, because other people didn't know it. But her father was also a range master. Now, I'm not talking about cooking on a grill. I'm talking about when they would go out and shoot. He was one of those guys that taught the newbies how to do it. And once he got them trained, he would qualify them as marksman, sharpshooter. And Pam worked at this. And she got better. And he qualified her as sharpshooter, expert. And finally, she made hog. Most people don't know, but hog is the word for a Marine that's a sniper. She is a trained sniper, I guess I should say, was, because I'm not for sure she isn't still alive. Honest, I think she could be moving in our midst right now, and we would not know it because she would be disguised. She can blend in. She's just like a chameleon, like a lizard. She was never, never, never registered, and people still don't know to this day, and probably most of the family don't. How do I know? Because I was her confessor. She would call up and tell me things that sometimes she shouldn't have. Now I'm going to tell you what her last job was and how it ended. Her last job was in Washington, D.C. She was working on her skills as a person of mind control, a person for disinformation. She was what they call a provocateur. She was one of these people who would go in someplace and just stir up the trouble, trying to hone her skills and abilities. And as she worked the bar, she would sit there and she would talk to the customers. One day a guy came in and she said, what do you want to drink? And he said, I want a beer. She turned around and she drew a beer and she set it down in front of him. She goes, I got a question. He said, what is it? She goes, what's your IQ? And he said, well, my IQ's 110, about average. She goes, oh, 110. So, what do you think of the game last night? Talk to him about sports. Talk to him about farming. Talk to him about the weather. Talk to him about bowling scores. She was good. He was buying, tipping. She was making the money. Another person came in. And she said, what would you like? And that person said, I would like a Chardonnay. She said, fine. She goes over, pours out the Chardonnay, hands it to him after she swirls it, stands there, and she goes, now I've got a question for you. What's that? What's your IQ? I hate to brag, it's 143. Very good. She stood there a minute, she goes, so, what do you think of string theory? And how about those names of those quarks? Up, down, top, bottom, strange, charm? He goes, yeah, I remember when those were discovered. And they continued on talking about physics and astronomy, black holes. It was amazing what the conversation was about. And she was right there. Finally, this lady walked in. Now, I told you she was a provocateur. She walked in and she said, what would you like? And the lady said, I want a shot of whiskey. I need it after today. She said, whiskey it is. She poured. She slammed it down. She said, I got a question for you. What's that? What's your IQ, ma'am? And the lady said, 43. And Pam leaned in close. And this is why she lost that job. She leaned in close to that lady and she said, do you really think you could impeach Donald Trump? And that lady got all hot, mad, and she ripped up everything she could have handled, and she threw it down, and she stormed out. And we know how that turned out. Pam got fired. She shouldn't have done that. But after the trial started, this man with orange hair looked her up and called her into his office one day, and she was escorted in, and he said, I want you to work for me. He said, you're just the person. We've checked your background out. We know how this works. We need you to work undercover for us. And she accepted. This is what she always wanted to be, was a Baptist assassin. A Baptist assassin. A ninja for Jesus, as you might say. She accepted the job. Then one day, about 2 weeks ago, I got a phone call. And this is the reason why I don't think she's dead. She said, I want you to meet me at Mount Vernon. I want you to meet me in the McDonald's. Oh, we know she would not go into a McDonald's. No, that's not healthy to even walk in. But I said, fine, because I wanted to know what was going on. And I said, okay, I'll meet you there. So I drove. I was afraid of her because I knew what she was capable of. And she explained to me what had happened in the job offer she had. She was dressed like a bag lady, and I didn't recognize her to begin with, but I walked in and sat down, and this bag lady came over and sat with me and talked, and she picked up my hamburger, and she ate some, she ate my fries, she went on, and finally I was like, lady, and she goes, it's me. Don't tell anybody. I said, okay, what's going on? She said, I've got a job as an assassin. And if I ever disappear or go undercover, you know that I'm in like a witness protection program. I've gone deep. And it wasn't too long after that I started hearing on the radio these assassinations that were going on. And then I got the phone call and said, Pam's gone. Pam's dead. I do not believe that she passed. I think she's still alive. And she slid to me just like this, a package across that McDonald's table. And she said, if you ever hear that I have passed away, you can open that package, but you cannot tell what is in there to anybody. I would hate to have to kill you to keep it quiet, but I will. Now I want you to know that I am not afraid of her. Not now. They have assured me from the highest ranks that she passed. So I'm going to tell you exactly what is inside that package. I opened it up and there, ah!
Oh no, oh no, oh no!
Go ahead and introduce the next one.
ABC.
Why bother?
Yeah. AARP.
You're going down.
Well, that did not go as expected.
Just as well.
My apologies. He was one of the weirdest of the weird, and honestly, I do believe this is probably the way he would prefer to have gone. So, Moving on, we have a mystery woman speaker today, and I hope that you all don't mind because he'll be all right there for a little while. So
step over him.
Yeah, just.
Step on him?
Just step on or around. He won't feel it. It doesn't matter.
Not everyone who knows me, but I was the best friend, the very best friend of Penelope. That's it. And so I came here tonight just so that we could take a look at her life. And sometimes you have to look very closely into her life. I need a tissue. I have lots.
We're good.
Okay. But we want to look at her life, and we want to see just what kind of life Peony lived. Now, I know that she loved flowers. And I brought just a little tribute for her. And I also know that she was very, very generous. She liked to share things with people. She didn't even mind sharing money.
You're in the wrong place.
And she was so loved by her church members that they decided, that she should have a church key. Her very own church key, so she could come in each life. Now, as far as her children, I know she loved her children. Being her best friend, I didn't know that. I know she loved her children. And what she did have a favorite. Now, that favorite child, she loved so much that whenever it came time, whenever it outgrew the shoes, she had the shoe bronzed so that we could see how much she loved the child. Now I have one more thing to say about her, about our dear Polly that has passed. And that's that she was extremely patriotic. She believed firmly that you should get out to vote early and vote often. And she was just such a good person. So actually, as a salute to her, we salute.
Bet you feel better.
Yeah. Well, being Pamela's middle child, I have learned quite a few things about her that I did not know previous to this day. I'm not sure how much of it was true. But I can tell you some things about her that definitely were true. Just before she passed, as you all have seen, she developed this passion for ribbon dancing. And I know you all know what that is. And that is my greatest regret for encouraging her along that path. Now, obviously, Because of that horrible accident, that's the reason that we are all here today. And I can't help but think that she wouldn't still be here if... ribbon dancing. However, we are celebrating the life of a mother and a sister and a grandmother and cousin and a best friend. Some things that I have learned from her in my lifetime, obviously not any of the murder or suspected murder, those skills were never passed on, thank goodness, would be to find a man with integrity and marry that man. And so I did. To be proud that you are a woman and keep up with those boys. And if you can run faster than them, then you run faster than them, and there's no pretending. To love the side of me that, like she did, makeup and hair and shiny things, but to also love the mud and the sweat and the smell of a horse and that feeling you get when you turn them loose and let them go as fast as they'll take you. And without her, these things may not have been in my life in any way whatsoever. So I will remember that about her. I will remember her unwavering commitment to her family and her kids, putting herself last on nearly every occasion for the sake of all of us. And I aspire to be as strong as her, though I, and in those ways, though I never fully expect that I will be, but don't give up and keep trying. That's something that she would want. So today we celebrate a great woman, a rock steady woman, on her birthday. But we celebrate it in a little bit of a different way this year. So now at this time, if all of you would stand, we will be releasing her ashes on the front steps of the church, which she loved so very much.
Ding dong, the witch is dead. Witch, oh witch, the wicked witch. Ding dong, the wicked witch is dead.
And that's all the words we know.
What, no tip?